Hey guys, welcome to my Diablo 3 beginners slash returning players guide. If you just recently came back due to quarantine or anything else, this is probably a video you could watch. So when you're ready, grab your cup of tea, sit back, relax, and enjoy. Now if you're watching this video in advance and you've never played Diablo before, never ever buy just the standard vanilla edition. You want to buy the Battle Chest edition for the Reapers of Souls expansion, because this is where you'll be putting the most amount of gameplay in, because this is what the game is all about. If you want to, you can buy the Eternal Collection to get another class if you're nostalgic and you want to play a Necromancer, but personally I would just stick to the Battle Chest edition, especially if you're a first timer. As for creating your class, it doesn't really matter which class you make, as all of them are pretty balanced and will get you up to the higher greater rifts or the higher levels quite easily. I would say just take whatever you want or what you like to play with. The general description and skill showcases are pretty accurate. For example, if you want to play a ranged character with bows, Demon Hunter. If you want to do a monk type character, the monk. If you want to summon minions, you can play a necromancer or witch doctor, and if you want to be a mage, simply play a wizard. Pretty straightforward. Now if you're a first timer here, you might as well play a seasonal character, and the only real difference is, if you already had characters, you cannot have access to the stash and stuff. You basically start fresh over, there's high scores, and you have set bonuses and things you can do within the season to get special stuff for your character. Always recommended to do overplaying regularly, especially if it's your first time. Don't worry about the high scores, just worry about getting the challenges done to get extra bonuses from the season. Once the season is over, your character will turn into a regular character, so not to worry, you won't lose anything after the season ends. Now there are two main game modes. You have the campaign and adventure mode, which includes rifts and bounties and stuff like that. The main game mode is the campaign and it has 5 acts. If you have the vanilla base game, it only has 4. To unlock the adventure mode, you require the Reapers of Souls expansion, and after completing Act 5, killing the final boss, this mode is unlocked. This will give you access to rifts, greater rifts, bounties, and more. The campaign is a good tutorial of the game and will get your character level levels 1 to 70, 70 being the max level and the level you actually start playing the game properly in adventure mode, where you'll spend most of your time gaining paragon levels and getting your build ready for greater rift pushing and gear farming. As for difficulties, you have difficulties ranging from normal to torment 16. If you're playing the game for the first time, simply stick to normal or maybe even hard if you're used to ARPGs. Once you're level 70 and you improve your gear and build, you can start pushing up the difficulty and going up the torment difficulty. This will give you more gold, more experience, and more legendary drops. In Diablo 3, you have towns in each act which are pretty much the same thing or serve the same purpose. You have various NPC shops which aren't that important, but you can get some low to mid tier gear while you're leveling up in the campaign in these shops. However, the main 3 NPCs you want to care about are the Jeweler, Blacksmith, and Healer. Starting off the Blacksmith, the main thing you want to know is that you can disassemble or destroy your items here, whether it's yellow, blue, white, or legendary items. You want to do it here with anything you won't be using for your characters at all, because you'll be using these crafting supplies to further better your build by using Kanai's Cube. More on that later. The Healer NPC is the most important NPC in my personal opinion, because you can reroll your item stats, or traits, or effects, or whatever you call it, prefixes, suffixes, you can reroll your item stats. And this is definitely important to know. You can also transmogify your weapons and armor to look cool or match sets, really nice, and dye them as well. The third NPC being the Jeweler is only important because you want to be upgrading your gems to the highest tier and put them into gear sockets. If you're using a weapon, you generally always want to be using emeralds for extra crit damage. Now this depends on the build and character, but generally speaking in your armor slots, so for example in your body or in your legs, you want to be putting in gems that boost the base stats that are important for your type of character. So if you're playing barbarian, those would be rubies for extra strength. If you're a wizard or a witch doctor, you want intelligence, so you'd be using topazes. If you quickly want to ID your legendary items, so remove the question mark to find out what the suffixes, prefixes, stats, etc., what type of item it is, you want to use this book. The Book of Cain or Chain will quickly ID all of your legendaries in your inventory. Very useful after just clearing a rift. And of course, like in any game, you have your storage, which can be upgraded to have more storage, and you can even save your builds in the closet. Pretty useful feature if you ask me, if you quickly want to switch around with your different builds. Now, skills in Diablo 3 really aren't that complicated, but you want to make sure that your skills work well together with your build. So if you're a fire wizard, just a random example, you want to use skills that are fire damage, because your gear will probably boost that damage with fire bonus increase. Now in Diablo 3, each skill has skill runes. Each of these skill runes make the skill act differently, change the elemental damage, or change how the skill works as a whole, reduces the cooldown, increases the area of effect, whatever it may be, they change the skill, and you can simply check them out by looking at the runes. You also have 4 passive skill slots, which just help you out through combat, and you can easily check out which ones you need for your build. Now, this one is very dependent on your build and character, but generally speaking, if a piece of gear is better than another piece of gear, it's because it gives you more base stats. So, for example, if you're a wizard, intelligence, and more critical hit chance and critical hit damage increase. Those are primarily the stats that you want to care about. Generally speaking, again, this depends on if you're pushing rifts or not, because you might need resist all or more life on hit, more damage for a particular skill you're using. It can really differ a lot, but generally speaking, you want to have as much crit chance as you can and as much critical damage and as much base stat increase. So for a wizard or witch doctor, this would be intelligence, and for a barbarian, it would be strength. Now, you don't just have regular legendary items, you also have ancient items or ancient legendaries identified by having a yellow outline, and you also have primal ancient legendaries, which are identified by a red beam on the floor and by a red outline. Now, an item I have to mention is Kanai's Cube. You can obtain this cube by doing a little mission in Act 3 after talking to Zoltan Kulla. I'll leave a guide to this item in the description below. You can use this item to extract legendary powers of certain items and use their passive abilities while having another item with a passive ability equipped in your character's interface. You can also upgrade rare items to random legendary items of the same type. You can also convert any set item you have double to another part of the set, for example, a glove to a helmet of a set. Which I didn't mention before, you also have legendary sets, which you can identify by a green outline, giving a set bonus when used in combination with each other. And there's much, much more you can do with Kanai's Cube, but it's just an essential bit of information you need to know about, because this is really a game-changing thing. Next up, we have Rifts, the main fun of Diablo 3 and why you should play this game. You have regular Nephilim Rifts, Greater Rifts, and Challenge Rifts. First of all, regular Rifts. You can simply open a rift by going to the Nephilim Obelisk and opening one up. You don't need any keystones to open these up any longer. You then basically kill enemies around the area to fill up a yellow bar. You can also kill elite packs, which drop orbs, which increase the progress on the bar even faster. These are called progress globes. At the end of the rift, when a challenge bar is filled up completely, a rift guardian will spawn. Once killed, the rift guardian will drop gold, loot, legendaries, crafting supplies, and blood shards. These blood shards can be spent in a shop in any town to get random items for a chance of getting legendaries. Now, depending on the difficulty you're playing on, you get a chance of getting greater rift keystones from the rift guardian. On Torment 11, you should be getting 2 greater rift keystones per rift guardian. These can be used to open up a greater rift. The difference between the greater rift and regular rift is that no loot is dropped apart from the loot from the rift guardian. Greater rifts give you more experience and are actually a test of your skill and build strength, because you can go up beyond the limit of Torment 16 in terms of difficulty with greater rifts. After killing the rift guardian, you again get a bunch of loot, including blood charge and legendaries, but you also have a chance of getting a legendary gem. There are various amounts of legendary gems, and depending on your character type and build, you might use one over the other. These legendary gems can be upgraded at the end of a greater rift only to increase their effectiveness. The chance of succeeding an upgrade on a legendary gem depends on the tier of greater rift and the level of the gem. There is one catch though, you're basically fighting against a timer whenever you're doing Greater Rifts. Now you can also empower Greater Rifts by using your gold, which can give you a higher amount of chances to upgrade your legendary gems. And finally, you also have Challenge Rifts, which you can do occasionally to get a special cache that contains large quantities of crafting materials. You can do this by using another person's build and basically doing a Greater Rift. Another thing which is important to know about are bounties. Bounties are basically missions you do in each act. Once you've completed all of the bounties in a certain act, you will get a cash reward from an NPC in town. This cash will then drop some loot, including legendaries and crafting supplies. You will need these crafting supplies for the cube, and you actually need to complete all the bounties from all the acts to get the necessary crafting materials to extract legendary powers from items to your cube. It is highly recommended to farm these on higher difficulty to get more supplies and in groups of 4 in public games. Just so you know, you don't want to be doing these solo because you can do them much faster with other players. One thing I'd like to mention if you're a solo player is hiring a follower. You can choose out of 3 of them in any town. If you go for the follower and you have an item called a Unity Ring and a legendary relic that doesn't let your NPC die, you literally can get a 50% damage reduction whenever you're playing solo, because 50% of the damage is taken by the NPC because it's split and he can't die or she can't die. So that's honestly insane. It's really, really good. Now, one thing I'd like to mention as well is the Death Breath material, one of the most important crafting materials in the game, which is obtained from a rare drop from elites or a guaranteed drop depending on the difficulty you're playing at. You can see these on screen. Now, it is recommended to have a character build to actually farm these, and what does actually help and gives you a 100% chance increase of getting Death Breath is the Sage set, also known as the Sage Journey set. I thought that might be worth mentioning in this guide. It is recommended to later on also have a speed farming build to get these quickly using that set. Now, another important thing to mention is the communities you can join. If you already have a level 70 character and you want to get power leveled in a season, or you don't want to start over levels 1 to 70 regularly, there are plenty of communities that can help you out. There are also communities that can help you with getting into rifts and farming blood shards called Rift It Forward and many other things, finding goblins, whatever it may be. You can join a community and talk in the chat and join other player their games and get some help. And surprisingly, even 9 years later, the community is still very active. And with that being said, that's most of the things or most important things covered in this guide for beginners or returning players to Diablo 3. There are of course other things like key wardens and uber bosses and some other things, but these are the most important things you need to know for when you're getting into Diablo 3. I hope you guys enjoyed this video and found it interesting. If you did, please leave a like down below and maybe even consider subscribing if you like my other content. Catch you guys in the next one. Peace.